Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Paul Sokin, the founder of the Jewish Studies program at the University of Waterloo. Welcome to the Better Communities Lecture. I would like to thank the Philip Reichman family for sponsoring tonight's event. It gives me great pleasure now to call on Dr. Tataryn, the acting president of St. Jerome's, to welcome you.
Thank you very much, Paul. It's my pleasure as the current acting president of St. Jerome's to welcome you on behalf of St. Jerome's University and, of course, on behalf of the University of Waterloo. This lecture series is an extremely important part of what we do as a university, communicate with the entire community, not just to ourselves, as often scholars are claimed to be doing. It's to be engaged with you and with scholarship and in looking at the issues, the important issues of our day. I'm particularly happy today, for those of you who were here at the last lecture, that the microphone is working.
Yes.
Welcome, and I'm sure that Dr. Berk will be giving us a wonderful and interesting lecture this evening. Thank you.
I just want to say a word of thanks to St. Jerome's and to Dr. Tataryn. I don't know if you realize this, but this has been an ongoing situation for I would say probably 10 or 11 years, where the Catholic College has hosted the Jewish Studies talks. I think it's a wonderful interfaith gesture, and we're very grateful to St. Jerome's. I'd like to call now on the Joseph and Wolf Lubavitch Chair of Jewish Studies, Dr. James Diamond, to introduce our speaker.
Thank you, Paul. Paul was saying this is a tradition of 10, 11 years having our Jewish studies lectures in the Catholic College. I recently defended the Pope in public, and I'm just signed a contract for my new book with Notre Dame Press. So I don't know, my mother's starting to question my pedigree. Tonight we have a very interesting lecture. I'd like to echo Professor Sokin's thank you to Philip Reichman and the Reichman family for sponsoring tonight's lecture, who are modest enough not even to have their name on the lecture. It's entitled The Better Communities Foundation Annual Lecture. And before I bring up the speaker, I just wanted to address you on one important point. That is, we have a number of talks on Holocaust subjects, maybe a preponderance of talks on Holocaust subjects. I just want you to remember, for the benefit of the public and the students, the death of Jews was the contribution of Hitler and his followers. The life of Jews, the cultural legacy, the spiritual legacy, the intellectual legacy, is what Jews and Judaism has left for the world. So when we listen to these lectures, people, I think, often have this misconception that this is Jewish studies. It is part of Jewish studies, but it is a catalyst, or it should be a catalyst, to what truly should be a memorial to those who died at Babi Yar and those who died in the Holocaust. That is something like a Jewish studies program at University of Waterloo, which is dedicated to the lives of Jews. It's dedicated to what Jews contributed to the world and not what Hitler contributed to the world, which is their death. So in introducing tonight's speaker, let me quote, of course, when you say Babi Yar, immediately what comes to mind is Yevgeny Yevtushenko's famous poem on Babi Yar, where he starts the poem off with, where he goes to Babi Yar, and he's startled by the fact that where so many thousands of people were killed, there's no sign. There's no memorial. There's nothing. There's a garbage dump. So he says, no memorial stands over Babi Yar, a drop sheer as a crude gravestone. I feel that it's the job of Jewish studies programs like University of Waterloo to perfect that gravestone so that it is not so crude and not so deep. So as a catalyst for that, let me introduce to you our speaker, well known to many of you. We love to have him back year after year, Dr. Stephen Berk, who is the Henry and Sally Schaefer Professor of Holocaust and Jewish Studies at Union College, Schenectady, New York. And he's going to address us on death in the Ukraine.
Good evening, and thank you for coming. And I thank the people here for inviting me back all of these years. The subject tonight is not a happy one. And I must tell you that in the beginning of the talk, I will spare you nothing. I will quote about what took place at Babi Yar. This is a year of anniversaries. It's the 50th anniversary of the Hungarian Revolution of 56. And for those of you that are interested in the Middle East, it's the 50th anniversary of the Suez Crisis that was so consequential for Middle Eastern history. Again, almost simultaneously with the crisis in Hungary. It is the 65th anniversary of the massacre, the slaughter at Babi Yar. What happened at Babi Yar, at least when we look at it from the vantage point of 65 years, gives us an insight into some of the internal dynamics of the Holocaust, tells us about anti-Semitism in its various guises, tells us about World War II in the Soviet Union, tells us also about the last years of Stalin in Russia or in the Soviet Union. And finally, believe it or not, Babi Yar, those people who died at Babi Yar, their deaths will resonate in the 1960s and the 70s and the 1980s. And Babi Yar will play a role in the creation of the Soviet Jewry movement, both inside the Soviet Union and outside of it. So let's talk, as they say, to use the old language, let's talk tachlis. Let's get down into the details. The bare facts are these. On September 29th and September 30th of 1941, Einsatzsonderkommando 4A murdered 33,771 Jews. Those are the figures tallied by the Nazis. In less than 48 hours. There is probably no time in the history of the Holocaust that one saw such a large number of people killed in a short period of time. I have to be careful here because as a student of the Holocaust, I am also familiar with the Holocaust at high tide. The Holocaust at high tide is not summer and autumn of 1941. The Holocaust at high tide is May, June, and early July of 1944, when the Hungarian Jewish community living outside of Budapest, to use that terrible colloquial expression of the Holocaust, went up the chimney at Birkenau or Auschwitz II. There may have been days, we're not sure of this, there may have been days in Birkenau, late spring, early summer of 44, when 20,000 Jews a day were gassed and cremated. So when I say that Babi Yar, 33,771, is probably the largest number in a 48-hour period, I think that is correct. But we're not altogether certain. So if I'm not to spare you the details, because when we teach the Holocaust, it can never be an abstraction. Never, never, never. It's not a work of fiction. And I know, because my students squirm, I beat around the bush for 3 or 4 weeks. I talked to them about the German accession to power. I talked to them about the Jewish communities that were devastated. Professor Diamond is right. Jewish history is more about life than it is about death. And a good Holocaust class should talk about the lives that were there before and the civilization that was created before. But sooner or later, you have to get down into, forgive the crudeness, the nitty-gritty. You have to talk about what took place. So let me quote for you. This is from a woman by the name of Dina Pronicheva, one of the few Jewish survivors of Babi Yar. She was referred to time and again by what is now a classic of Holocaust historiography. That is a book written by a young Ukrainian, young at the time, Anatoly Kuznetsov. This was a book entitled Babi Yar, written while he was living inside the Soviet Union, had to amend it for the censors, then defected or left the Soviet Union and put out a revised edition, adding, he said, the parts that he knew were taken out by the censor. If you wish to read the book, read the amended or the revised edition. Again, the title of the book is Babi Yar. The author is Anatoly Kuznetsov. This is from, again, this Dina Pronicheva, the sole or one of the few survivors of Babi Yar. She is writing about how the Jews were brought to the ravine about 3 to 4 miles from the city center. We'll talk more about this, about how it was done, and so on. She talks about how they are marching. They really do not know what is happening, but then they are put through a funnel. That is, they have to run the gauntlet of German soldiers. She writes, quote, "It was very narrow, some 4 or 5 feet across. The soldiers were lined up shoulder to shoulder with their sleeves rolled up, each of them brandishing a truncheon or a club. Blows rained down on the people as they passed through. There was no question of being able to dodge or get away. Brutal blows, immediately drawing blood, descended on their heads, backs and shoulders from left and right. The soldiers kept shouting, 'Schnell, Schnell,' laughing happily as if they were watching a circus act. Everybody started shouting and the women began to scream. It was like a scene in a film for one brief moment." Then Kuznetsov writes, "Dina caught sight of a young man she knew from her street, an intelligent, well-dressed boy sobbing his eyes out. She saw people falling to the ground. The dogs were immediately set on them. One man managed to pick himself up with a shout, but others remained on the ground while people pressed forward behind them and the crowd carried on, walking on the bodies and trampling them into the ground." As horrible as this is, it pales not into insignificance, but it really pales compared to what comes next. This is from the testimony of one of the killers, one of the men in Sonderkommando 4A, who will be placed on trial when the war is over. And he will write, "Once undressed, the Jews were led into the ravine. 2 or 3 narrow entrances led to this ravine through which the Jews were channeled. When they reached the bottom of the ravine, they were seized by members of the Schutzpolizei, that is the political police, and made to lie down on top of Jews who had already been shot. This all happened very quickly. The corpses were literally in layers. A police marksman came along and shot each Jew in the neck with a submachine gun at the spot where he was lying. When the Jews reached the ravine, they were so shocked by the horrifying scene that they completely lost their will. It may even have been that the Jews themselves lay down and rose to wait to be shot. The moment one Jew had been killed, the marksman would walk across the bodies of the executed Jews to the next Jew, who had meanwhile lain down and shoot him. It went on this way uninterruptedly, with no distinction being made between men, women, and children. The children were kept with their mothers and shot with them. I only saw the scene briefly. When I got to the top of the ravine, I was so shocked by the terrible sight that I could not bear to look for long. In the hollow, I saw that there were already 3 rows of bodies lined up over a distance of about 200 feet. How many layers of bodies there were on top of each other, I could not see. I was so astonished and dazed by the sight of the twitching, blood-smeared bodies that I could not properly register the details. There was a packer at each entrance to the ravine. These packers were Schutzpolizisten, whose job it was to lay the victims on top of the other corpses so that all the marksman had to do as he passed was fire a shot. When the victims came along the paths to the ravine and at the last moment saw the terrible scene, they cried out in terror. But at the very next moment, they were already being knocked over by the packers and being made to lie down with the others. The next group of people could not see this terrible scene because it took place around the corner." End quote. In this murderous attack upon the Jews, the Germans would always be able to count on support from the indigenous population. So there were some Ukrainians there as well. And so the question arises, We are talking about 1941, almost in the middle of the 20th century. The inevitable question is, how could it be in the middle of the 20th century that a nation whose name was synonymous with Kultur, with culture and a high degree of civilization, could bring about, provide the impetus for what indeed is nothing short of mass murder? Permit me to go in seriatim, as they say. That is, to look at those who are playing a role in the murder, including those who are on the receiving end, the Jews. I begin with the Ukrainians. Ukrainian anti-Semitism had been a fact of life going back for centuries. The Jews were different in religion. The Jews seemed to serve the Polish overlords of the Ukraine. And indeed, the Jews were the quintessential middlemen. The Jews were lessee class par excellence. That is, they leased lands, they leased estates. Any student of Jewish history is familiar with the economic dynamic. A Polish nobleman living in the Ukraine would rather spend his time in Kiev and Krakow or Warsaw, not out in the boonies. The result is going to be he will call upon a Jew to act as a bailiff, the Jew will advance him a certain sum of money, and the Polish nobleman will say to the Jew, in effect, take what you can from the Ukrainian peasants. You don't have to be a Sigmund Freud to understand that this is not a dynamic or a process that will endear the Jews to the Ukrainian and the Polish peasantry. Explication should never become exoneration. What's going to take place is, again, murder. The year is 1648, 1649. For students of the history of the Ukraine, this is the time of the Khmelnytsky Revolt. Bogdan Khmelnytsky and his Cossacks will sweep out of the Ukraine. And by the time they are finished, they will have killed, according to some estimates, somewhere between 100 and 125,000 Jewish men, women, and children. It is sufficient to say that had the Holocaust not taken place, this would be the great devastation of Jewry in the European continent. This is going to be followed by other, let us say, by other pogroms, other attacks. The 19th century will see also the use of anti-Semitism as a political weapon, both by the Tsarist government and by the revolutionary movement as well. And that is going to spread to the Ukraine. As one revolutionary put it, one narodnik or populist put it in the early 1880s, the pogroms are the bridge across which the revolutionary movement must move. If the Jews are to suffer, then that is just a tragedy for the Jews. For first the peasants and the working class will attack the Jews, then they will move from the Jews to the landlords, and then from the landlords to the government itself, and we shall have our revolution. Unfortunately for the revolutionary movement, and most unfortunately for the Jews, the pogromchiki never got past the Jews, and indeed the revolution would be a long time in coming. In the early years of the 20th century, the Ukraine would be rocked and socked by another event. 1911, a Ukrainian boy, probably no more than 13 or 14 years old, is found murdered and his body poked filled with holes. That's like adding up one and one and coming up with two in the eastern part of Europe. The charge will surface that this was a ritual murder or blood libel. The Jews were up to their old tricks from the medieval period. That is, the Jews killed Christian boys and girls at the time of Passover to use their blood for the baking of the unleavened bread. A 35-year-old Jew, Mendel Bayless, is going to be arrested and placed on trial. It's an interesting trial, that Bayless trial. And for those of you that like to take your history through fiction and film, that, of course, is the subject of Bernard Malamud's book, The Fixer, which was made into a very good film, if you can get your hands on it now. In the end, Bayless will go before a trial. The jury will be rigged. The evidence will be rigged. But in the end, Mendel Bayless will be acquitted by a jury of Ukrainians, none of whom had gotten past the eighth grade. It shows you, incidentally, for those of you that are interested in political science, although the words are not fashionable, this is the difference between an authoritarian society and a totalitarian society. In authoritarian Russia, it was still possible for a Jew to get something resembling a fair trial. In Stalin's Russia, there will be no such fair trials. In Hitler's Germany, there will be no such fair trials. But in backward anti-Semitic and reactionary Tsarist Russia, there was a limit beyond which the government could not go. In the late teens, 1918, 1919, 1920, the alleged link of Jews with communism would lead large numbers of Ukrainians to participate in massacres against the Jews. 60,000 Jews in the Ukraine are killed between 1918 and 1920. 1,200 Jewish settlements are going to be wiped off the face of the earth. And then the Ukrainians will have their own tragedy. And that is, somewhere between 1932 and 1935, we believe that several million, maybe as many as 4 to 5 million Ukrainians, will die as a result of the so-called contrived famine that Stalin wrought upon the Ukrainian people. This is a terrible, terrible tragedy. I don't want to spin this out too far, but simply to give you an idea that it is not only the Jews who have suffered terribly under Soviet rule and under Tsarist rule. There were other people who also suffered. In 1989, in the period of Perestroika and Glasnost, Soviet newspapers were allowed. This is the deal that Gorbachev struck with the Soviet intelligentsia. You support Perestroika, and I will allow you to fill in the blank pages of Soviet history. And so what happens is, a newspaper in Kiev asks its readers to send in letters about the time of famine in the early 30s. They expect to receive tens of letters. They get thousands. They publish some of them. The most poignant and the most tragic of them run something like this. I'm a man who's over 80. I know my time is coming. I'm going to die, he says. I've got to tell the truth. He said, I was a member of the party, a high-ranking member of the party. I was the head of a food requisitioning unit. We went out in the 30s, and I was told, you go out and you take the food from the kulaks, the so-called rich peasants. I go to this farmhouse. There's a woman, 3 scrawny children. I do what I was taught to do. I slap her around. You kulak bitch, he said. Tell me where the grain is. She says, I have no grain. My husband died of starvation last week. Look at my children. Do you think I have any grain? He slaps her around again. He notices a pot with boiling water. There's the grain. Picks up the top of the pot. There's the carcass of an infant. These people have been reduced to cannibals, or to cannibalism. The point in the story is, there's tremendous antipathy to Soviet rule within certain segments of the Ukraine. That's going to mean that when the Germans come into the Ukraine, they will be welcomed by large numbers of Ukrainians. This is a chapter in Soviet history that only in the end of the 1980s were Soviet historians allowed to write about. Even today, Russian historians don't like to talk about this chapter. This, incidentally, for those of you that are history, remember I told you, you study this and you get an insight into World War II. This is one of the great missed opportunities of the Nazis. They squander a good deal of the goodwill that is generated towards them in Eastern Europe. Because for many people, if you have to choose between the communists and the Nazis, if you're not Jewish, the initial response is to choose the Nazis. But the Nazis, by their brutal policies, are going to really alienate large segments of the indigenous population. It means that Ukrainians, in many cases, will welcome the Germans in. The Ukrainians will identify with the Germans. Some will. Some will identify the Jews with communism. Some will carry truncheons and clubs at Babi Yar. Some will look with indifference. Some will mock the Jews as they go to their deaths. Some will benefit from the apartments that the Jews are vacating. And some, if we are honest, will go beyond, above and beyond, transcend the normal limits, and will shelter Jews. No blanket statements from me on Ukrainians or anybody else. When all is said and done, and this is an important point, whether it is in Poland, you can talk from today until doomsday about Polish anti-Semitism. Only an idiot would deny anti-Semitism in Poland or anti-Semitism in Hungary, or in the Ukraine, or in Belarus. But the fact of the matter is, if the Germans did not come, none of this would have taken place. Again, I say it. If the Germans had not come, none of this would have taken place. And therefore, one must focus at least some attention on the other element, the most important element. The Nazis bring with them, to use the German expression, a Weltanschauung, a worldview that you're all familiar with. Die Juden sind unser Unglück. The Jews are our misfortune. It is used at every Nazi party rally. Hitler didn't say it. He did say it. He's not the one that coined it. The man that coined it was Heinrich von Treitschke, a German historian of the 1870s. Die Juden sind unser Unglück. The Jews are our misfortune. Or as the historian Schall Friedlander puts it, the Nazis believed in redemptive anti-Semitism. It was not enough to say that the Jews caused X, Y, and Z. You go beyond that and say that unless we exterminate the Jewish people from the face of the earth, Germany and the Aryan race cannot assume their rightful place in history. No nuances here. The Jews are responsible for all that is wrong. We can only be great again. The Third Reich can last only for 1,000 years, only if the Jews are eliminated from the face of the earth. If the Nazi Party had this reservoir of racial anti-Semitism in it, and exterminationist anti-Semitism, the quintessential, let us say, epitome of indeed Nazi thinking was to be found in that institution or organization, and I use the term with some caution here, that referred to itself as the conscience of the Third Reich. This, of course, was the SS, the Schutzstaffel, literally the protection guard. When Heinrich Himmler, the Reichsführer SS, is appointed the head of the SS, there are 250 members of the SS. As late as 1934, there were only 40,000 members of the SS. By the time one arrives into the war, if you include the Waffen-SS, which should be included, we are talking about somewhere between 1 million and 1.25 million men. Now, for the SS, ein Befehl ist ein Befehl. An order is an order. And what did Himmler say? An astonishing statement. If the Führer asked me to kill my mother, I would do it. We will follow any order of the Führer. And when the order comes to exterminate the Jews of the occupied areas of the Soviet Union, we believe that decision or order is communicated verbally by Hitler to Himmler, from Himmler to Heuss, from Heuss, or actually from Himmler to Heydrich, from Heydrich to Heuss, the commandant of Auschwitz, and indeed down the line. And what's going to take place is the SS will create an institutional structure for the murder of Jews. What that means is Hitler has declared this is a war of civilizations. We must destroy the Jews. And so an already existing part of the SS is now restructured. In September of 1939, that is before the German invasion of the Soviet Union, but at the time of the German invasion of Poland, the Nazis had created special mobile killing squads, Einsatzgruppen. Those Einsatzgruppen in German-occupied Poland had as their primary task the murder of Polish intellectuals and Polish resistance fighters. A number of Jews would be killed as well. Now in the spring of 1941, the Einsatzgruppen are restructured. There had been 6, now there will be 4. Einsatzgruppen A, B, C, and D, numbering altogether a shade less than 3,000 men. A is in the north, in the Baltic states, B is in Belarus, C is in the Ukraine, and D is in the furthest most parts of the Ukraine, and indeed in the Crimea. It is Einsatzgruppe C and its special subunit, Sonderkommando 4A, that carry out the attack upon the Jews. They will be very, very effective. Not the least of their effectiveness is going to come from another fact of life. Study Babi Yar, study the Holocaust in the Ukraine and elsewhere. You can shatter one of the great myths of contemporary German history. The myth that still is there in Germany, still there, is that yes, the Nazi state murdered 6 million Jews. Most Germans, virtually all Germans, with a little handful of exceptions, will say that that is correct. They will all accept that. But then they will say something else. The murders were committed by people in the party and people in the SS. Our gallant and valiant soldiers in the Wehrmacht, the German army, played no role in the murder of European Jewry. The evidence that we have indicates that that point of view is absolute nonsense. The Wehrmacht from top to bottom was riddled by German officers and enlisted men and conscripts that were inculcated with the worst and most vitriolic forms of anti-Semitism. Listen to this statement. This is from Field Marshal Walter von Reichenau. He's the commander of Army Group South. This is what he says in an order in the fall of 1941. Quote, this is from a general, not an SS man. Quote, the most essential aim of the war against the Jewish Bolshevik system is a complete destruction of their means of power and the elimination of Asiatic influence from the European culture. In this connection, the troops are facing tasks which exceed the one-sided routine of soldiering. Therefore, the soldier must have a full understanding for the necessity of a severe but just revenge on subhuman Jewry. The army has to aim at another purpose, that is the annihilation of revolts in the hinterland, which, as experience proves, has always been caused by the Jews. The Wehrmacht bought into a particular point of view. Every partisan is a Jew, every Jew is a partisan. And as the Nazis moved deeper and deeper into the Soviet Union, the Partisanschina, as it is called in Russian, partisan warfare increases, and the Nazi temptation or the Nazi belief is, kill the Jews and you eliminate the partisans. In short, indeed, the army is going to provide important, essential cooperation. In fact, the decision to murder the Jews at Babi Yar is a decision that is reached on September 24th at a joint meeting of the SS and a representative of Army Group South. And again, to make the point, for those of you that are familiar with the Holocaust in the Ukraine, there is a very, very unfortunate incident. There's a mass killing in a small town not far from Kiev. For some reason or other, the parents of a number of about 100 Jewish children are killed, and the children are left alive. These are children, for the most part, under the age of 5 years old. They're put in a house where they wallow in their own feces and their own urine. Nobody brings them anything. What is to be done with these children? A group of chaplains attached to the German army become aware of this and act to try and save these children's lives. There's even a member of the Wehrmacht that tries to save the lives of the children. It goes nowhere because the SS demands that the children be killed. And what is even more astonishing is the SS get an order from who? From General von Reichenau. Von Reichenau says, kill them. This from an army officer, not an SS man, and the children are all killed. There is, of course, another component. What about the Jews? What about them? There were, before the war, 160,000 Jews living in Kiev. Approximately 20% of the city was Jewish, maybe even more. By the time the Germans get there, there will be probably 60,000 to 70,000 Jews. large numbers of Jewish men were conscripted into the Red Army. These are very, incidentally, very poignant. This is a very tragic case, because those who survived the war serving in the Red Army will go back to Kiev and find that nobody in the family is left alive. Tens of thousands of Jews had been evacuated. But again, don't misconstrue this. In the 50s and in the 60s, there was a myth spread by people who were sympathetic to the Soviet Union in the United States that tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of Jews were saved because the Soviets evacuated them. The Soviets did evacuate large numbers of people, not because they were Jews, but because they were factory workers or essential workers. That's why large numbers of Jews were sent or evacuated to Siberia and Uzbekistan and other places. Thank you very much. The point in all of this was, this is one, incidentally, one of the great achievements of the Soviet administration during the Second World War. Under a man who will become very famous later on, a man by the name of Kosygin. Kosygin earns his spurs in the Communist Party. He's one of the better trained. He's an engineer and an economist by training. He's the one that oversees the evacuation. It's not designed to save Jews. It's designed to save essential workers. That's how the Jews are saved. But there's something else. Why did so many remain? Didn't Jews understand what they were in for? And the answer is no. And if you were my students, and you should bless the ground you're walking on that you're not, because at this point in time, I would walk down from here and ask one of you, why is it that Soviet Jews did not know what was happening or what was in store for them? And because we want to finish this before Shavuos, I will give you my own answer. And the answer is that on August 23rd of 1939, the Soviet Union and Nazi Germany had signed what was called by a number of names, the Hitler-Stalin Pact, the Molotov and Ribbentrop Pact, or the Soviet-German Non-Aggression Pact. All of this is going to mean that from August 23rd to 4 o'clock in the morning of June 22nd of 1941, that's the time of Operation Barbarossa, the German invasion of the Soviet Union, until that time, the Soviet Union and the Germans are allies. There will be no mention in the Soviet press about what's happening to the Jews in Poland. No mention of concentration camps, no mention of anything. So what does it lead to? It leads to one of the more bizarre statements, or testimony that appears at Nuremberg. And that is, there's a letter dated from the summer of 41. In the summer of 41, an SS man walks into a town and is greeted by the rabbi in the town, who comes to him with the more prominent Jews in this Ukrainian town and brings him the traditional bread and salt and says to him in a perfect German, "We hope that our relations with you will be as good as our relations were with German soldiers in 1918 and 1919. And the SS man writes to Himmler, "Don't these people know what we are about?" And the answer is many of them do not. They do not know what in fact is taking place and what is going to befall them. That's why many of them do not flee to the East. In addition to that, many Soviet Jews, like many Soviet citizens, believed in the propaganda, the pre-war propaganda and the wartime propaganda. The pre-war and wartime propaganda said, "We may be attacked by Germany. The Germans will have initial advances and successes, but the mighty Red Army, like a coiled spring, will be launched against the Germans, and within a matter of days, in a matter of weeks, the German army will be thrown out of the occupied areas of the Soviet Union." The student of the Second World War knows that anybody who believed this was in for a very difficult time. The Red Army doesn't go from defeat to defeat in the summer and autumn of 41. It goes from catastrophe to catastrophe. This is Stalin's great mistake. This is what Khrushchev referred to in that famous de-Stalinization speech at the 20th Party Congress in 56. This was the ultimate charge against Stalin. He didn't prepare us. He had the intelligence information. He didn't prepare us. 85% of the Red Air Force is destroyed on the ground within the first 48 hours of Operation Barbarossa. Kiev will be lost. And the number of Red Army soldiers that are killed, wounded, and taken prisoner is 600,000. The men who general the Russian army or the Red Army in this period of time are absolute incompetents. General Budyonny, he was a good cavalry commander when cavalry was synonymous with horsebacks, with horseback riders. He knew nothing about tanks. Defeat after defeat, those Jews and others who thought that the Red Army was coming and we can take whatever the Germans are going to dish out were sadly mistaken. That again is going to be a tragedy. And so the deed is done. 33,771 people are dead. It is also an interesting thing here. More history and more Holocaust than you ever wanted to know. You look at this, over 33,000 dead in less than 48 hours. Then one of the great arguments of the Holocaust, one of the great verities of the Holocaust that Jews in particular have clung to ever since 1945 doesn't look as sure as it really was. That is, how many times have we heard they should have bombed the railroad lines? They should have bombed the crematoria. They should have bombed the gas chambers. And had they done so, we all believed large numbers of Jews would have been saved. Don't you believe that for a single moment? What our parents and our teachers told us when we were children, always meant to be in a positive way, works in a terrible negative way as well. Do you remember a million years ago when we were all young? And we said to our parents and our teachers, I can't do it. And what did our parents and teachers tell us? Where there's a will, there's a way, right? Where there's a will and there's a way, you can murder Jews without gas, without gas chambers and without crematoria. This is only one part. Babi Yar is only one part of the actions of the Einsatzgruppen. In 18 months, they will kill at a minimum 1,400,000 Jews. This is different than the rest of the Holocaust. In the ghettos, 20% of each ghetto is dead before the deportations, dead from starvation and disease. In the camps, the Jews are brought to the killers. But here, the killers are brought to the Jews. And there's something else that's interesting here that we often do not think about. Over 33,000 Jews killed in less than 48 hours. There weren't more than 150 Germans involved in this. The Holocaust is done on the cheap. At Auschwitz, 1,500,000 people are going to die. 90% of them are Jewish. The total number of Germans that circulated through Auschwitz in 4 years does not exceed 7,000. It doesn't cost the Germans very much to kill large numbers of Jews. So the deed is done. And when it is over, and when the war is over, there is silence. No one in the Soviet Union speaks publicly about Babi Yar. And in fact, in those other places of mass murder, outside of Riga is Rambouli. Outside of Vilna is Panari. In Kharkov, it's the tractor factory. The place Eastern Europe and the former areas of the Soviet Union are loaded with places of massacre. Nobody mentions anything about them. Why not? And the answer is difficult to fathom. This is a time, I would suggest to you, not giving you the definitive word, this is the time in Soviet history that is referred to as the Zhdanovshchina, the period of Andrei Zhdanov. This is a time when a new phrase enters the language. I'll give you the English translation of it. In English, it is rootless cosmopolitanism. A rootless cosmopolitan is someone who looks to the West and has no faith in Soviet society and Soviet culture. And in many times, on many occasions, a ruthless cosmopolitan is a Jew. And by the end of the 40s and the early 50s, when ruthless cosmopolitans are arrested, their names will appear, and then in parentheses will be their original Jewish name. For many Soviet Jews assimilated to the point of taking Russian names. Do you know how crazy it gets? Listen to this. A prominent professor of philosophy at Moscow State University will lose his position because in the beginning of a class, he made the following statement. We are going to talk about the greatest Marxist in all of history, Karl Marx. That's probably an accurate statement. But it's the wrong statement. The greatest Marxist was Lenin, the beloved Ilyich. Or a high school history teacher will lose her position because she starts off a class by saying, students, today we are going to talk about the great French Revolution. The word in Russian for great is Veliki. Veliki or great can only be used in connection with the October Revolution. That's the only revolution that is truly great. In early 1952, Pravda, the party newspaper, will carry an article. There'll be listed about 13 names. 11 of them, probably 11 of them, are Jewish. These are doctors. They are accused of poisoning Soviet citizens and even trying to kill the Khozayin, the great leader himself, Stalin. Stalin will use anti-Semitism as a political weapon to advance the interests of the party, to eliminate opponents, and to justify to the people why the economy is not moving ahead as rapidly as is possible. A Soviet equivalent of Die Juden sind unser Unglück. If you want to use the Jews as a scapegoat, don't start talking about Babi Yar and Jewish suffering during the war. And then in the early 50s, before he dies and certainly after he dies, the Soviet Union experienced a dramatic policy shift. Believe it or not, are you ready for this? From 1945 to 1948, the best and most effective speeches at the new United Nations supporting Zionist claims for a Jewish state in Palestine emanated from Soviet diplomats. The Soviet Union became the great champion of Zionism. This at the same time as in 1948, that Stalin was arresting the Soviet and Jewish intelligentsia and 4 years later murdered them all in 24 hours. But outside of the Soviet Union, the Soviet Union played the role of supporting Zionism. And as every student of the history of Israel knows, the only country that sent legally and blatantly, openly, that gave weapons to the Haganah and later the Israel Defense Forces was Czechoslovakia. A Czechoslovakia that was under Soviet influence. For all of his great support for the State of Israel and for all of the encomiums that are heaped upon Harry Truman, Truman did not allow a single weapon to pass from the United States to the State of Israel. The Soviets gave captured German material to the Czechs gave it to the State of Israel. What he wanted, again, this is a matter of conjecture. We really don't know this for sure. We need more look, a greater look at the archives. What is he doing this for? It's certainly not a burst of philo-Semitism. Golda Meir, bless her soul. Bless her soul. A good and decent woman was not at her sharpest when she said in 1948, she was the first Soviet Israeli ambassador to the Soviet Union, said, Premier Stalin feels terribly sorry for the Jews. And that is why he is supporting Zionism in the creation of the State of Israel. That's not one of the smartest statements that Golda Meir ever said. I will also tell you, and I may have made reference to this before, to show you what a strange place we are talking about. When Golda Meir was the Israeli ambassador, the Soviet Foreign Secretary, Vyacheslav Molotov, hosted her at a magnificent party. And then Mrs. Molotov walked over to Golda Meir and said, quote, Ich bin eine jiddische Tochter, end quote. She spoke to her in Yiddish. I'm a daughter of the Jewish people. No one knew that Mrs. Molotov was Jewish. Poor Mrs. Molotov will be immediately arrested. and spent 5 years in a Soviet concentration camp. Her husband will remain as the Soviet foreign minister. We are talking about a very strange place. So when I tell you that Stalin supported the State of Israel, I can tell you certain reasons why. He probably miscalculated in dealing with Ben-Gurion. He saw Ben-Gurion as a leader of the socialist Zionist movement and probably believed that Ben-Gurion would make Israel a Soviet bastion in the Middle East. Wrong. In addition to that, he really wants the British out of the Middle East. This is the way to get them out. Whatever the reason may be, he supports the State of Israel. And then he shifts. And you didn't have to be a real chacham or a wise man to understand why there's a shift. You total up on one side the number of Jews in Palestine or Israel, the number of Arabs in the Middle East, and if that is not good enough, the disparity is not great enough, you ought to add the number of barrels of oil, there's no question as to whom you're going to support. If you're going to tilt towards the Arab side in the Arab-Israeli conflict, you don't talk about Babi Yar. You don't talk about the Holocaust. And beyond that, for those of you that know your diplomatic history, there's the famous toast at Potsdam in 1945. Stalin raises a glass and says, to the Russian people, who have forgiven us all of our mistakes and have supported us throughout the war. Everybody drinks a toast. And then he says to Clement Attlee, if I could, I'd kill all 28 million Ukrainians. To him, the Ukrainians were collaborators. But the Soviets had to conciliate, accommodate themselves to the Ukrainians after the war. If you want to really get the Ukrainians once again integrated after being occupied by the Germans in the Soviet Union, you do not, I repeat, you do not dwell on Babi Yar and you do not dwell on Ukrainian collaboration. So it's all going to mean the 40s will go, the 50s will go. Jews will go to Babi Yar as they will go to Rambouli, as they will go to other places. They will go silently. They will talk about it by word of mouth. There will be small groups of Jews that will mourn the dead at Babi Yar. And then the bombshell. 1961. Yevgeny Yevtushenko writes a poem. This is the time of the thaw. This is the time of Khrushchev. Soviet editors are a little bit more ambitious, are a little bit more willing to take risks. And so in the leading Soviet literary newspaper, Literaturnaya Gazeta, the poem Babi Yar appears. It is hedged in. Yevtushenko knows his limits. You cannot criticize the Communist Party for anti-Semitism. You cannot criticize the Russian people for anti-Semitism. But the message is clear. There is no memorial at Babi Yar, and anti-Semitism is still to be found in the country. That's 1961. 1962, another good and decent man who had escaped the purges by the skin of his teeth, now in the period of the thaw, wants to do a good thing. For the music lovers, a familiar name. Dmitri Shostakovich. Shostakovich writes his 13th symphony. It's produced in Moscow. The symphony is interrupted by readings, that is, deliberately interrupted. It's part of the 13th symphony. People read parts of Yevtushenko's Babi Yar. The proverbial hits the fan. Lots of people talk about it. The proverbial genie is out of the bottle. People now talk about Babi Yar. People now ask why there's no memorial. And the Jews now go in larger numbers, and some non-Jews go to Babi Yar. They demand a marker. They demand a memorial. And then the Soviets make one of their typical mistakes. The heavy hand of Soviet bureaucracy descends upon the people who want to go to Babi Yar. You put flowers there, the KGB men take them away. You insist that the flowers stay, they rough you up. One of the leading dissidents wants to fly from Moscow to Kiev. Natan Sharansky, they lock him up. Boris Kachubaisky, another leading dissident, they lock him up. Inadvertently, the Soviets, by their policies, their harshness, their stupidity in dealing with the issue of Babi Yar, create and revitalize the Soviet Jewry movement. Babi Yar becomes the touchstone. People who are loyal citizens of the Soviet Union now begin to be alienated. People become dissidents. People become emigres or potential emigres. The heavy hand of the Soviet bureaucracy under Brezhnev turns a growing number of Soviet Jews into people who want to leave the Soviet Union, and Babi Yar plays an important role in this. We are in a great institution of learning here. I know the University of Waterloo is a very, very fine place. Here, in a university setting, one should appreciate art forms in all the genres, poetry and literature. And if you know your Russian history, you know that what Yevtushenko was doing is consistent with Russian intellectual history beginning in the early part of the 19th century. Art must serve the purpose of the revolution. Or, as one literary critic put it, when men and women are starving and do not have shoes on their feet, you do not paint pictures of beautiful women and you do not write love poems. That's what Yevtushenko is doing. Or to use the language of the dissident movement, this is Aesopian language. You can't express yourself in prose politically. So what you do is you use poetry and literature. This goes back to Gogol, it goes back to Tolstoy, it goes back to Turgenev. And that's what Yevtushenko is doing. And because it is so important, you've got to indulge me. Here is the poem that shook the Soviet Union to its very core. Please bear with me. No gravestone stands on Babi Yar, only coarse earth heaped roughly on the gash. Such dread comes over me, I feel so old, old as the Jews. Today I am a Jew. Now I go wandering, an Egyptian slave, and now I perish splayed upon the cross, the marks of nails are still upon my flesh. And I am Dreyfus, whom the gentry hound. I am behind the bars, caught in a ring. Belied, denounced, and spat upon I stand, while dainty ladies in their lacy frills squealing poke parasols into my face. I am that little boy in Bialystok, whose blood flows spreading darkly on the floor. The rowdy lords of the saloon make sport, reeking alike of vodka and of leek. Booted aside, weak, helpless, I, the child, who begs in vain while the pogromchik mob guffaws and shouts, save Russia, beat the Jews. The shopman's blows fall on my mother's back. Oh, my own people, my own Russian folk, believers in the brotherhood of man, but dirty hands too often dare to raise the banner of your pure and lofty name. I know the goodness of my native land, how vile that anti-Semites shamelessly preen themselves in the words that they debase, the union of the Russian people. Now in this moment, I'm Anna Frank, frail and transparent as an April twig. I love as she, I need no ready phrases, only to look into each other's eyes, how little we can sense, how little see. Leaves are forbidden us, the sky forbidden, yet how much still remains, how strangely sweet to hold each other close in this dark room. They come, no, do not fear. These are the gales of spring. She bursts into this gloom. Come to me quickly, let me kiss your lips. They break the door? No, no, the ice is breaking. On Babi Yar, weeds rustle, the tall trees like judges loom and threaten. All screams in silence, I take off my cap and feel that I am slowly turning gray. And I too have become a soundless cry over the thousands that lie buried here. I am each old man slaughtered, each child shot. None of me will forget. Let the international blare forth. When Earth's last anti-Semite lies in Earth, no drop of Jewish blood flows in my veins. But I am hated by every anti-Semite as a Jew. And for this, I am a true Russian. I leave the more literarily inclined among you to tell me whether this is great poetry or not. But we often know that it is not the greatest of prose or the greatest of literature or the greatest of poetry that shakes a country to its various foundations. This man, Yevtushenko, and Shostakovich will provide those nails that will lead to the destruction of the Soviet Union. We must remember the people at Babi Yar. They are a warning against racism, a warning against collaboration, against complicity. You think of Babi Yar. You should also think of Darfur. But also let us think of these two men, non-Jews, who stood out and provided us with a quintessential example of civic courage. Remember Babi Yar? Remember Yevtushenko? Remember Shostakovich? Because that this you can take to the bank. We are entering into a very, very difficult time and perhaps a horrendous future. Thank you very much.
I think you can see now why we bring Dr. Berk back every year. I've heard Dr. Berk speak many times over the years, and as a professor of literature, I'm very gratified to see him speak about the power and the meaning and the force of literary work as an historian. We have time for a few questions, so please. While you're thinking about your questions, let me say first that for those of you who are not on our email list, please do give me your business card or write your email address down, and I'd be happy to take it, and we can add you to our email list. And also, please remember that there's a reception afterwards, which everyone is invited to participate in. Yes, Dr. Berry.
A Ukrainian Yevtushenko?
Yevtushenko is a man, that's a name of Ukrainian origin.
Are they related or
the honest answer is I don't know. What do you say, Marston? No. To the best of my knowledge, he refers to himself as a Russian, not as a Ukrainian. Although usually, 9 times out of 10, ENKO is usually that's an indication of a Ukrainian name.
Yes, Michael Grant.
A substantial number of Jews fled east to try and get beyond the German lines. And I'm curious, when you said that the population of the Ukraine, the Jewish population of the Ukraine, knew nothing of what was happening in the West, was it that the Jews who were fleeing to the east, had no contact with the Jewish population?
Didn't right. The question is, some Jews fled, some Jews stayed. Why? Now, I said that the Jews knew nothing. That's not altogether true. There were people that knew. After all, before the Hitler-Stalin Pact, remember, in the eyes of the Soviet Union, the Nazis are fascist reptiles and crocodiles. So the German anti-Semitism and German policies, including Kristallnacht, are known to people in the Soviet Union. So there are people that know, and then we come into one of the most difficult, your question is a good one, and it's a very difficult one to answer. Let me give you an anecdote. I have a good friend that still to this day cannot understand. He was in a shtetl, Utyan, in Lithuania. His father heard a speech on the radio by Adolf Hitler in 1933, after Hitler came to power. His father said, "They're going to kill us. We've got to get out of here." He was one of a handful of people from Utyan that left. When does, and this becomes an important question in the Holocaust, when does information become knowledge? When do you hear something, read about it, and internalize it and believe that this is a piece of information upon which you should act? Some people believe the Germans will come. What can they do? What can they do? Not even those who say they're going to kill us. Could anybody have imagined what happens at Birkenau at what is called the Rampa? A train comes in, the people come off the train. Women and children in one line, men and boys in another. You go before the SS physicians. To the right, you're into the camp. To the left, you're up in the gas chamber. Within 2 hours, maybe an hour and a half, you've gone up the chimney. Nobody can believe this. Nobody in his worst or her worst, wildest imagination could ever have believed this. So the question, again, is a good one. The answer is not as good as the question, but I am telling you that what happens here is a matter of individual interpretation. Why do some people hear a speech and say, we got to get out of here? And others say, we can ride this out. I don't know the answer to that. All I can tell you is the evidence is overwhelming here that many people chose to leave. That is, many people chose to leave, and many people with the same pieces of information chose not to leave. Now, one of the sources, now here again, we don't know how this plays out. When the Germans occupied Poland, and when the Soviets, as the Germans invade Poland on September 1st, and the Polish army reels back, Stalin, implementing one of the terms of the Hitler-Stalin Pact, sends the Red Army to partition Poland on September 17th of 39. So Poland is in effect divided, partitioned again. Tens of thousands of Polish Jews flee from the German-occupied area of Poland into the Soviet-occupied areas of Poland. Some of them move even further east. Now again, why do some people move further east? And why do some people stay? You have to make, forgive me, I'm not being condescending here. What I tell my students again and again in a Holocaust, in my Holocaust class, is the Holocaust is a time of tough choices. Really tough choices. And in fact, the choices are irrevocable choices. You're in Warsaw, September 20th, 1939. The Germans are about to enter the city. Do I stay in Warsaw where my family, my friends, my apartment is, where they all are? Or do I go east? The Stukas and the Messerschmitts are strafing the roads. They're bombing the trains. And some of the Polish peasants are not filled with enthusiasm about seeing large numbers of Jews. Do I stay in Warsaw or do I go east? You make the wrong decision, you're dead. The wrong decision is to stay in Warsaw. The right decision is to go east. People are faced with these choices all the time. And as in the case with other issues, it is the way you interpret the information that is forthcoming. I didn't mean to spin out the answer, but that's the best I can do on what is a good question.
Another question. Who is it?
I can't see.
Go ahead.
Dave. Oh, David, yeah.
Could you elaborate on your ominous warning at the end of the line?
This will get me into another area. The nightmare of the 1950s, which we were able to finesse, is now the bona fide nightmare. If you can remember back to the 50s and 60s, the nightmare that we used to speak about was the proliferation of nuclear weapons. That is now a fact of life. That's what I mean. We are in for a difficult future. This is not a talk on the Middle East. All I will tell you is that the prospect of a nuclear-armed Iran is a very dangerous thing. That's what I meant.
I think we have time for another question or two at the most.
My students are petrified of me, but you are real people, and you don't even know me. You don't even know me enough to be frightened of me.
Okay, then I think what we will do, thank you, Steve.
I think what we'll do then is leave you to approach Dr. Berk individually with your questions. I'm trying to remember if there's anything else. I've invited you to approach me and put you on the mailing list. Invited you to the seminar. Oh, yes. Again, I want to thank the sponsorship of Philip Reichman and family for making this evening possible. And I'd like now to call on Dr. James Walker of our Department of History at the University of Waterloo to thank our speaker.
Where's the, Stephen. Stephen, we've had you here so often at Waterloo, more than anybody else in our Jewish Studies program, that we've started to think of you kind of like an old shoe. You know, you're comfortable. You're a good fit. You make us feel good. But tonight there's a pebble in the shoe, isn't there? A nail in our shoe. We're not comfortable tonight. The Holocaust, of course, has filled with 6 million poignant stories, but surely one of the most distressing is the story of Babi Yar. Stephen, with your usual eloquence and passion, you have made us feel that tonight. I don't think any of us who were not part of it could ever understand the Holocaust. But we can take lessons from it, as demonstrated tonight by Stephen's erudite talk, so richly contextualized. Stephen, we thank you very much.
Thank you all for coming. I hope you recognize our miraculous weather for this time of year, cooperating and allowing us all to be out in this evening. Thank you again for coming. We'll see you again end of March.